178 laws that differentiate on the basis of sex.
Women can't work overtime.
We have to get credit cards in our husband's name.
We're not allowed to work in
mine. Can't patrol New York.
This is amazing.
You think you can change the country?
I know they call her the notorious RBG. Are you guys now BFFs?
I hear that she has seen the film and she's telling her friends about it, which is a good sign. And then actually we're going out to Washington and so we'll all be celebrating together. So I'll be hanging out with her then. I don't know if you can say the word hanging out with the justice, but
yes, you know. Can, absolutely.
Why not, why not?
What did you say your name was?
Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
Did she know who you were? When she found out you were playing her, was she familiar with your work?
Well, she had been involved in every single draft of the script. She had overseen it from when Daniel started writing it to the point where she was like, please don't show me any more drafts.
Right.
I've got the idea. She'd actually seen a film I did called The Theory of Everything, and she had said, yeah, that she approved the casting. And so when I went into the film, I knew that I had her blessing, which made such a difference.
I'm Ruth Ginsburg from Brooklyn.
And why are you here, Miss Ginsburg?
Mrs. Ginsburg, actually. My husband Marty is in the second year class. I'm at Harvard to learn more about his work, so I can be a more patient and understanding wife.
I read somewhere that to get into a character, you're kind of obsessed with the shoes that they wear, so you wear them. In this case, what are you wearing?
I mean, part of what I love about acting is that, you know, you get up at sort of 5 a.m. in the morning, you go into the trailer, you're sort of a bit bedraggled, and then you come out of the trailer and the makeup and costume and you're Ruth Bader Ginsburg. And part of that process is, you know, the wigs, contact lenses, teeth, and then obviously the phenomenal costumes, which Isis had done so beautifully and captured just how much, you know, Ruth is a fashion icon as well as, you know, a political hero.
All the little brush-offs, the dismissive pats on the head, it matters, Marty.
Why? You know what you're doing is important, so who cares?
Well, here's to blind dates, because to me, this movie isn't just about the subject matter. What a portrait of a great marriage.
I know. I mean, really, they had the most perfect partnership in marriage. I mean, it was progressive by today's standards, much more so by the 50s, 60s, and 70s.
Well, especially him, which was so interesting. I mean, as far as the husbands in this film go, he was the best.
Oh, for sure. I mean, I want to marry the guy.
The film is a love story. It's about two people who had absolute respect for each other and helped each other in their careers as well as, you know, bringing up children. So they're a couple that one definitely looks up to. And so did Daniel, actually, who wrote the script, who's Ruth's nephew. Part of the reason he wanted to tell the story was that his aunt and uncle, he always saw what an amazing marriage they had, and he wanted to know how they had achieved that.
Just tell me what you want.
Nothing. I want nothing. I want you to go to work and wow your bosses and clients and be the youngest partner in the history of
the
firm.
That's not fair.
I want you to walk me home, Marty.
You said you learned more from him by reading his cookbook
than
anything else. Besides going into the baguette recipe, what did the cookbook teach you about him?
You know, it was just written in his voice. He was really funny and really charming and really smart. And the recipes sort of echo that. There's one recipe where, you know, she was very close with Justice Scalia, and he would every year go and hunt like a wild boar or some sort of game, and he would bring the meat back to Marty, and Marty would prepare it for like a big meal for the entire Supreme Court. And there's the recipe for Scalia's boar ribs goes on and on and on for pages and pages, and now do this, now do that, blah, blah, blah. And at the end of the recipe, it says, now remove the boar ribs from the oven, grab them, throw them in the trash and enjoy the sauce, because it's really the best part of the recipe. You know, I mean, he was just funny.
And get your emotions in check.
You've burst.
Did you know anything about this guy?
No, and no one did. I mean, we knew what we knew from newspaper clippings, but we didn't, the internet. In a weird way, dodged a bullet because there was no sort of source material. I couldn't find the guy. We couldn't find pictures of the guy. I didn't have the added burden of having to sort of mimic someone who's an icon, you know. So I was sort of able to invent him from whole cloth, or just rely on the text.
So that's it? You're gonna take them all on at the same time?
Love the scene where you give her advice and say basically, would it kill you to smile?
Yeah.
Like, just the simplest things can make a big difference.
But also the most misogynistic thing you can say as well. Like, what happened to the charming Ruth, the smiling Ruth, the wink at the judges, you know? So in a weird way, he was very of the era as well.
What's the best advice you got along those lines from a friend? Maybe going to an audition and a friend gave you kind of this, hey, would it kill you to do this, or?
I had a good piece of advice once that said, a very powerful producer once said to me when I was very early on in my career, even before my career, he said, never fly yourself to Los Angeles.
What?
He said, wait for them to fly you, because I was working out of New York. And I kind of stuck by that and waited until I had the opportunity, because there's nothing worse than buying yourself a ticket to Los Angeles. Right. And it's like, oh, now you're just still doing nothing here. So why are you here?
Well, thank goodness that worked in your favor, because you could still be in New York hanging out. Where's that phone call?
I know.
I'm never going to L.A.
Exactly.
Maybe I'll drive there. He didn't say anything about driving yourself.
No, he didn't say, I'm sure it applied.
Working
you think
lawyers.
I can't be persuasive?
Oh, I've never been more certain about anything in my life, Ruth.
You don't get to tell me when to quit.
Initially, you don't take on her case. And I would imagine that as Justin Theroux, your friends pitch you stuff all the time. Have you ever had to say no? Because they're friends in the movie.
I say no to my mom like six times a week. Like, she's always pitching me something. She's like, you know what would make a great movie? I'm like, it's always what I think about, like, the guys who work at SNL as writers. Like, they must hear, you know what would be a great SNL sketch? It's like, oh, they must roll their eyes and say, I can't do it anymore. Yeah, I mean, I have some friends that'll pitch me stuff, like, but it's, you know, it's, they also don't realize how hard it is to get something done.
Right.
So they're like, you know what you should do? You should make a movie that's like this. You should get De Niro to be in it, and you're like, yeah, okay, I'll just call De Niro and make sure that happens. Not gonna happen.
I don't understand why you're acting like that's such a bad thing. You're out there training the next generation of lawyers to change the world.
Because that's what I wanted to do.
One of my favorite scenes is when she kind of gives that little dig and she says, everything I'm doing now, I actually learned from Columbia, you know, to the Harvard.
Oh, line. I love that
movie. I love that scene.
So good.
What you're doing now, most of it you learned on what movie set? Was there a film that you did where you learned the most?
That is such a good question. I think it would have to be one of the most formative experiences was doing Like Crazy, which I shot in Los Angeles, and it was mostly improvised. And somehow I learned so much on that film, and obviously from Anton. And it was one of those very, very special experiences. And I think it taught me how important it is just to improvise, to experiment, to let go. You know, when you get to set, you've got to bring a certain amount of technique, but also you've got to let it fly in the moment.
Martin Ginsburg will be signing all of our checks someday.
You're a smart girl, Ruthie. You married a star.
Did you guys dine at her house?
Not at her house. Felicity went to her house and spent time with her there. We went to the Supreme Court and spent time with her in her private chambers, and then we went to dinner with her afterwards.
Do you bring her a gift? Like, what do you do when you're about to go meet her?
I did.
What'd
because
you bring
I was
her?
Like, I want an in.
Yeah.
You know, I'm gonna butter her up a little bit. I brought her a scarf because she loves scarves.
Yeah. Have you seen her wear it?
No, and I'm really offended. Yeah.
Are you going to try Antonin Scalia's wild boar recipe next time?
Maybe, I just have to find a wild boar. Yeah.
The word woman does not appear even once in the US Constitution.
Nor does the word freedom, Your Honor.